Current focus in terms of understanding the impact of COVID-19 on the world economy is the revisions to the world economic outlook that the IMF updated us on yesterday. That revision was obviously very extensive. It covered all key aspects of the world economy. And when you look at the adjustments they made, they essentially revised every single major economy weaker. From their perspective, most economies are now going to experience an outright recession. By that we mean for 2020 as a whole, their GDP will decline year on year. There are two countries that stand out as an exception to that. The one is China, and obviously the IMF feels that China will effect some sort of recovery in the second half of this year. I guess starting in perhaps the second quarter already, and then carrying on that recovery into the second half. So for the year as a whole, they have China growing or reflecting a positive growth, although the growth rate is substantially below where China has been performing in recent years. And the second country that they think will record positive growth is India. India has been growing typically around the 6 or 7% in recent years. And what the IMF is saying about India is that because they are in lockdown and have extended the lockdown, that India perhaps not as badly impacted in terms of the spread of the virus, the fallout on a whole range of social and economic issues. And I guess they feel that India will effect also some form of recovery late in the year. But if you exclude those two countries, and you can debate whether or not those forecasts are right, every other major economy in the world is expected to record a negative 2020 in terms of GDP. How much negative? Well, the numbers vary from, I guess, around about 2 or 3% all the way up to around about 8 or 9%, depending on the country. If you look at the world economy in total, the IMF is saying that world GDP will decline by 3% this year. And then go into a fairly substantial recovery next year that starts to approach 6%. I'll chat about what that recovery requires. But in terms of the decline this year, the 3% in world GDP, that decline is far worse than what occurred at the time of the financial crisis. So if you look at the chart, you can see the decline in 2009. That was only a fall off of 0.1%. Yet it was the worst financial crisis in 100 years. That gives you some idea of the severity of the economic contraction that is unfolding at the moment. The other thing that stands out is this is the worst global economic performance since the Great Depression. So you'd have to go back all the way to the 1920s, early 1930s, to see anything that is similar to this in terms of rate of decline. Obviously, the Great Depression lasted longer, whereas this is expected to really impact through the course of this year and then turn into an economic recovery next year. But the severity of the decline is very stark in terms of this data. The other thing that stands out in the IMF numbers is they do think that the developed world will decline far more than the emerging market environment. So they're saying developed market growth is down 6.1%. And if you put 6.1 minus on this chart, you can see how severe that is, suggesting that most of this at the moment is impacting Europe and the United States. All of Europe expected to be in recession. Particularly the big economies, France, Germany, Italy is badly affected. All of those declines in the order of 6, 7, 8%. And then equally the United States expected to decline by almost 6% this year. The United States' data has already started to soften very substantially. And I'll just show you one or two numbers as to the extent of that decline that is now unfolding. If we look at the recovery in 2021, what the IMF is saying is they expect, again, all of the major economies to show fairly substantial positive growth next year. Now, in order for that to materialize, the IMF makes it clear in their report that the impact of the virus has to start to fade early in the second half of this year. That means that by that stage, let's say the third quarter, most economies have to be out of lockdown, people have to be returning to work, and you're starting to get economic systems re-engaging. If at that point we start to see the emergence of new infections, which remains a very key risk, let's say that we've got now to this third quarter of the year, beginning of the second half of the year, countries have ended their lockdowns, but soon after ending lockdowns, we start to see infection rates pick up again. And those infection rates start to spread, forcing many countries to go back into lockdown during the third quarter of the year, and then try and bring the spread of the virus under control for the second time. If that starts to occur, then the IMF's forecast on the screen will be wrong, that you cannot get that type of recovery into 2021 if you extend this lockdown deep into this year and potentially into next year. And to me, that is probably the single biggest risk to these types of forecasts. And that is that, yes, the lockdowns appear to be working. Many countries are showing that the rates of infections have topped out and are starting to moderate. With lags, obviously, not every country is showing the same pattern. But once the lockdowns end and you get people going back to work, are you able then to control the rate of infection? So far, the focus is in that respect on China, because China is the most advanced in terms of controlling the infection. They are the furthest away from the peak of their infection. And if you look day to day in China, the number of infections have slowed materially. It's not as if there are no infections. They're pretty much around about 60 to 80 new infections every day, but that's nothing like they were incurring previously. And you see the same pattern if you look at South Korea. They also got the virus under control. They also brought the number of new infections down very dramatically. So they seem to be also able to control the number of new infections each day. Again, that number is not zero, but it is more in the order of 20, 30 a day. So if those countries can continue to control this and continue to open up their economies, it will give this type of forecast a huge amount of support. Already we think that China is about 80% back to normal. In other words, when you look at a whole range of daily data that tries to gauge what is happening to shopping activity, what is happening to the production of energy, electricity, are restaurants open, are people moving about, all of those indicators suggest to us that China is about 80% back to normal. Now, it's very difficult for China to go to 100% back to normal. Part of that is the lockdown that is happening in other countries around the world. The more other countries remain in lockdown, it's very difficult for China to do business with the rest of the world. China's exports remain heavily constrained. And then anything to do with travel or tourism equally under enormous pressure. So China is very unlikely to be able to go back to 100% of normal, but 80% back to normal is a very substantial achievement and a very clear positive for an economic rebound next year, as long as those infections remain under control. So a big, big focus on that element within China. When it comes to this, the biggest economy in the world, the US, we only now starting to understand the extent of the downturn that is likely to play out. And so I just want to show you a couple of numbers that I hope illustrate the types of revisions we're likely to see in the data. The first one is the number of people moving through US airports. We've got daily data, so the U.S. provides us with a daily update on how many people are going on U.S. airlines, either domestically or internationally. And what you can see since the beginning of March, that number is now declining in the order of 95%. So year on year, you've had effectively a 95% decline in the number of people using airlines. This number will continue to decline and can literally go close to 100%. That gives you some idea of the magnitude of the adjustment we're having to put into the US economic data and therefore by implication the US economic forecast. The other number that is very stark at the moment is something called weekly jobless claims or initial jobless claims. This data comes out once a week on a Thursday, and what it tells us is how many new people are applying for unemployment insurance in the US. This works similar to our UIF, any sort of unemployment insurance around the world, where as soon as you're unemployed, you are entitled to claim some sort of benefit from the government. That works the same in the US, and once a week they update us on how many people have so far applied. And in the last 3 weeks, a total of 16.7 million new people have applied for unemployment insurance. That's telling you that literally 16.7 million people in 3 weeks have become unemployed. That's a dramatic increase. And if you look at the history of this data, that has never occurred in the past at any point. And the magnitude of the rise dwarfs anything that occurred during the global financial market crisis. So it's very clear that we're going to see a huge jump in the US unemployment rate. Already we've seen job losses spike up. The latest number where they showed a decline in employment just for the month of March of 701,000. That number is going to explode from here as the US adjusts to this lockdown. So all of this data is incomparable with historical numbers. You can't relate this to any event in the recent past. These numbers far exceed any sort of downturn that occurred during the global financial crisis, which should be screaming at us that this represents a massive forecast risk. All of our economic models that try and map this are pretty much useless because the relationships don't hold. The magnitude of the move is so substantial that you're really in the guessing game as to how severe an impact this will be in the shorter term. That being said, though, the most important thing to watch is what I said right at the beginning, is when does the lockdowns end around the world, and are the countries able to control the spread of the virus once the lockdowns start to end? Last chart on the US is just to show you the monthly employment numbers. As I said previously, that's going to be some shocking data. The March number shows a decline of 700,000. And relative to recent history, that's a major about turn. So if you look at the retail sales data that came out recently, huge decline there. If you look at anything to do with industrial production, motor vehicle sales, any of those types of indicators are clearly going to be sharply weaker over the coming months. When it comes to South Africa, the IMF is saying that we're going to decline this year by 5.8% and then rebound next year by 4%. Now, the 5.8%, while it's very substantial, is actually fairly in line with what most people are now concluding. Our own forecast sits at about minus 5.5%, given the extended lockdown. That number has got a bit worse. If you look at what the Reserve Bank is forecasting, they're saying that this year South Africa will decline by minus 6.1%. And most private sector economists are expecting South Africa to decline somewhere between 5% and 7%. So to me, this number feels about right from the IMF. The big question is, can you get that rebound of 4% next year? And again, that 4% is entirely feasible as long as we are able to control the spread of the infections once we end our lockdown. At this stage, I am expecting our lockdown to be scaled back at the end of April. Obviously, the government extended it by 2 weeks. I thought that extension was inevitable, given that many other countries have been facing lockdowns that equal 2 months, and in China's case lasted for between 70 and 80 days. So for a country to get away with a lockdown of only 21 days was probably too optimistic. And I think that the extension of 2 weeks in South Africa was entirely appropriate, given what we know about the international data on the spread of this virus. But I do think once we've gone through that phase, the government will be looking to scale back the lockdown measures. Now, they can't go from full lockdown into no lockdown at all. That would undoubtedly lead to a resurgence of the virus. And so they have to find a way to manage that in a phased approach. Let's assume that they get that right and that South Africa can systematically return to work in the second half of this year. Then that 4% recovery is feasible. Could anything else go wrong with that 4%? The answer is yes, and that is that post this virus effect, we're hoping that government starts to focus more earnestly on trying to effect structural reforms in this country. It's very clear that the path South Africa was on before the virus was not sustainable. The growth rates we were experiencing were less than 1%, and there was nothing that was changing that dynamic. So in order to get the 4%, not only do you have to manage the end of the lockdown effectively, but you also got to start to make a material change to some of the key policy decisions that are outstanding in South Africa. In other words, you've got to start to effect structural economic reforms. And that, I think, is a big question mark as to whether the government has had enough of a wake-up call with this virus and the consequent effects to understand that they've got to urgently lift South Africa's growth rate. So what are countries doing about this other than trying to manage the health component? Let's have a quick look at what central banks and governments are trying to do. So most central banks in the world have applied some sort of monetary stimulus. By that we mean they've cut interest rates very dramatically. South Africa cut rates very recently. And most economies have moved interest rates down sharply and are either at or close to their lowest interest rate ever. In addition, the major economies, particularly Europe and the United States, have expanded their printing program. They call it obviously QE because it just sounds better, but the Federal Reserve is effectively re-engaged with QE and printing money. And what they've said this time is that there is no limit to how much money they're willing to print. They haven't set any target or any guideline. They've simply said they will print whatever is required to support the economy at various levels, which means that this number is just going to continue to increase in terms of how much additional liquidity the U.S. Federal Reserve is introducing into the U.S. economy. In the last 3 weeks, they've already added $1.5 trillion U.S. dollars, and I expect this number to increase at a very rapid pace over the coming weeks as the U.S. economy, as the Federal Reserve floods the U.S. economy with liquidity. On its own, obviously, that's not going to really solve any problems, but it definitely supports the financial markets. In addition to this, the U.S. government is going to introduce a rescue package of $2.2 trillion U.S. dollars. In other words, the U.S. government is going to spend $2.2 trillion in an effort to support the economy. That represents more or less half their entire national budget. How are they going to fund this? Where are they going to get the money from? It simply means that the U.S. government is going to borrow an additional $2.2 trillion. So who would provide them with that? Well, in reality, the Federal Reserve is going to end up buying most of this debt through the printing of money. In other words, the Federal Reserve is funding the expansion program of the U.S. government in order to support their economy. What's the U.S. government going to do with this $2.2 trillion? pretty much support every aspect of their economy, whether it's large business, small business, whether it's direct payments to individuals. In other words, individuals during the course of this week, next week, etc., will be receiving checks in the post, which they can cash and utilize in any way they want. They will be supporting unemployment insurance, providing food parcels, a whole range of measures. They're going to be bailing out certain industries. Already they've made an agreement to bail out the airline industry, all of that with $2.2 trillion. So you put those two things together, and that is a massive support program. Now, many people say to us, but surely this is highly irresponsible, and surely this would simply lead to inflation. And ordinarily, I'm going to go back two charts. If you print this type of money in most economies, you would end up with hyperinflation. So why does the US not experience that? And it comes down to one simple thing that is very difficult to wrap your head around because it relates to psychology, and that is the strength of the dollar. Even though the US is printing so much more money and introducing so much more US dollars into the world economy and into their own economic system, the world still loves the dollar. And because of this love for the dollar and this clamor for holding US dollars as a safe haven asset, the US can get away with this. They can get away with printing this amount of money and not having the dollar come under significant pressure. Now, let's say that the South African government tried the same thing. They printed this amount of rands. In order to get away with it, you would need a huge number of people locally and internationally to fall in love with the rand. That seems highly unlikely. Therefore, if we did this, it would simply lead to hyperinflation and a massive deterioration in the value of the rand. Therefore, all emerging markets and most other economies would struggle to do what the US is doing. So given that, what is the backstop for South Africa? What is the backstop for an emerging market? Given what they're doing in the US, how do we support our economy, especially if we don't have the muscle that the US has or that Europe has? The one option, obviously, is keep cutting interest rates, which the Reserve Bank has done. And there probably is actually scope to cut a little bit more, maybe another 0.5%. But already interest rates in South Africa are at their lowest level since the 1970s. And you would have to argue that the Reserve Bank is pretty much doing what they can. They have started to buy South African government bonds in what called the secondary bond market, and they are printing money to buy that. But here's the proviso. Firstly, they're not doing that in large number. In other words, the amount of money involved is not that substantial. And secondly, they plan on withdrawing that additional liquidity from the economy once the system is a bit more stable. So it is a risk that the Reserve Bank is undertaking. But from their perspective, it is a manageable risk within the context. So effectively, you could argue the Reserve Bank's doing a element of quantitative easing in South Africa, but it will look and feel vastly different to what's happening in Europe and in the United States. And there is no intention on the part of the Reserve Bank to expand that buying program through the widespread printing of money. So I think the Reserve Bank is doing pretty much all they can. They're providing liquidity, they're supporting the market. What other mechanisms do we have? Well, unfortunately, our government pretty much squandered the balance sheet before we got to the infections. So the government balance sheet was already fragile, government finances already under significant pressure. We've seen tax revenue fall away in each of the last 6 years. We've seen government debt having to ramp up substantially to support SOEs and other spending programs. So our government simply does not have the funds to try and bail out the South African economy to any significant extent. And in fact, the situation gets worse because of the economic downturn in South Africa. it means we're going to have another substantial tax revenue shortfall. And I'm estimating that shortfall in the order of 70 to 80 billion rand this year. That means that government is going to have to, on top of everything else, borrow an additional 70 to 80 billion. All of this is going to put government finances under pressure at a time when foreigners are withdrawing their money from South Africa, at a time when our credit rating has moved to below investment grade. And what this is doing is it's forcing the South African Reserve Bank to consider using external funding. Well, what do we mean by external funding? We mean essentially going to the IMF or the World Bank to look for funding. Now, when it comes to the IMF and the World Bank, they operate differently. The World Bank is essentially there to help economies develop. So that is, if you want to, say, build a road and you don't have money, you want to build a hospital, you want to build a dam, and you don't have money, then you can go to the World Bank and ask them for assistance. But if you as a government get into financial trouble, that is not the role of the World Bank to assist you. That falls into the ambit of the IMF. So in our instance, we would have to go to the IMF and say we need financial support. Now, what type of financial support is available? Pretty much anything that you need. But here's the problem. The more financial support you need from the IMF, the more conditions they attach to that financial support. So you don't get the money and then are able to do whatever you want. The IMF simply says, we will give you the money in tranches over a period of time, and each tranche, each payment of the bailout is dependent on you reforming key aspects of your economy. And from our government's perspective, they would resist that very strongly. In fact, the Minister of Finance made a point of saying they're talking to the IMF only about COVID-19 funding, and not about money to support the broader government. The difference is that if you go to the IMF and you get some support, but that support is only earmarked to help you with the fight against COVID-19, then the IMF will provide that assistance with very few conditions or even no conditionality. Now, why does the government then not do just that? The reason they can't do that is that the IMF will only give you a modest amount of money under the COVID-19 program. They're not going to give you a huge amount of money because it's only supposed to be targeted to fight COVID-19. And that may represent a dilemma for the South African government. If they're going to need a lot more money, it's going to come with conditions. And I think that is all ahead for South Africa. So, how much money has the IMF and the World Bank provided? The World Bank has already provided countries with what they're calling health support. So this is money not to bail out the government, but money to give to various countries for them to afford tests for COVID-19 or masks for health officials or to help with ventilators or other medical equipment. So this money that the World Bank has already allocated, firstly, it's relatively small in the context of the IMF, of the World Bank, and secondly, it is purely there to provide medical equipment and medical support. In addition, so far, 90 countries have approached the IMF for funding as a result of COVID-19, and to date, the IMF has granted 11 countries support packages. I need to stress, those support packages to the 11 countries are fairly small and targeted only at the fight against COVID-19. For South Africa, we may require more money than simply fighting COVID-19. And that is what the Minister of Finance, together with the Cabinet, will have to grapple with. So from my perspective, the economic data in the short term is going to look extremely bleak. The rates of change are going to plummet dramatically. The GDP decline is going to appear eye-watering. It is that extensive a decline in economic activity that is ahead of us in terms of the data. The key question is not that. The key focal point is not the extent of the decline in GDP. The key focus is, can countries manage the ending of the lockdown and still contain the spread of the virus? If they're able to get that right, then financial markets should rebound quite strongly in anticipation of economies rebounding next year. If we can't manage the ending of the lockdown and we see a resurgence or a second round of infections, then unfortunately the opposite will happen. Financial markets will be under pressure, more money will leave emerging markets, the rand will come under more pressure, and obviously it would represent a more stark outlook. We're encouraged by the progress that South Korea is making. We're also encouraged by the progress in China. And we do think that at the margin, Europe is systematically getting their infections under control. And some of those countries have started to scale back the lockdown measures. I think this has a way to go before we know whether we've gained meaningful success. And critically, the United States will represent the pinnacle of whether or not the world economy is able to get on top of this. So a lot of rough data ahead, a lot of anxiety, but hopefully we can return most economies to some form of economic activity in the second half of the year, which would then set us up for a stronger rebound in 2021. That's all from my side. Hope that makes some sense. Thanks a lot.